Call your sister, call your brother, call your aunties, call your mother. This is a Don't Watch That podcast with Jess with the Best and Wes with the Rest. Coming live from your favorite two designers. What's going down, Jess? How you doing?
So everything's going fine. I'm, you know, chilling here, living here, working on different projects, a whole bunch of fashion content, fashion shows, a whole bunch of little bit of everything. And yourself?
Same old. You know, ain't nothing, same nothing. Just maintaining to the next day, you know, waiting till Friday and all that good stuff. But what are the new projects you started working on recently?
I'm actually working on a couple custom outfits for like baby showers. And I have like a dancer outfit that I'm working on. I'm also working on a color. I'm also going to be working on this collection too for the end of March, which is actually before my birthday. So it's going to be kind of exciting because my birthday is April 2nd. So if I can get all of this done within that time, that'll just be like, it'll just add to like my birthday joy. So.
Oh, I don't think that would be a problem for you to finish that up. You have a lot of work ethic, so it's definitely going to work out and shape up soon. Yeah, not like a lot of people who like kind of like has the money to do certain things and just don't have the talent for it. I know for a fact that you, of all people, have the talent for certain.
Thank you. I appreciate it. But what about you? You have any projects that you're working on?
Actually, yes. And I think you know about one of them because you're actually featuring in one of them, if everyone didn't know. Yeah. We are starting a collection and a documentary called The United States of America Versus Art. It's going to be hosted by DFA Co. Actual artwork and actual fashion. Actual facts. So, yeah, definitely I have that coming up. And the 1993 collection, well, archive, right, anyways, is coming up very soon as well. Mm-hmm. A lot of good things for you guys. So hopefully you guys will be in tune and ready for when it comes. But back to what I was saying. I had segued into something very, very important that people need to know. Having money and no talent doesn't equate to anything. I'm just letting you guys know. I'm just saying. I'm sorry to yell, but that's just the way I see it. But how do you feel about that, though, Jess?
Having money with talent or having money with no talent?
Having money with no talent as opposed to having talent with no money, because it's a very common conversation. It's a very common concept anyways, but not a common enough conversation.
I want you to go first.
Well, in my opinion, those who don't do teach, and those who don't teach, well, don't know. So the people who have money but no talent sit behind a corporate desk. You know, they're silent partners, but as long as they hold certain discretions that they want from certain people, that's all that matters, as opposed to the people with no money and all the talent, which is, you know, raw talent as far as learning how to sew from scratch from the beginning, like I did. Like before I could even get my sewing machine, I had to learn by hand. My mom wasn't about to waste no money on a sewing machine. I didn't know what I was doing, you know? So we kind of have to like organically bring ourselves to talented status in order to say like, yo, you know, I feel like that's where the term starving artist comes from, if you really want to be technical. But your opinion on this situation, though?
I mean, I think if you have no money and talent, you could definitely get money. You know what I'm saying? Like, because you have talent. But if you have talent and, if you don't have talent, but you have money, you can teach yourself a talent, you know? Because you could definitely teach yourself a talent. But I think both parties are still the same because... I think that we would still be considered the same only because we could both do the same thing. Correct. But we just don't have the same qualities, if that makes sense. But it could definitely be there over time. You understand what I'm saying? Like, so if I'm broke but I have talent, I could definitely gain money with my talent over time. And if I'm rich with no talent, I could definitely pay to learn talent, multiple talents or multiple trades, just so that, you know, so that's basically how I feel about it.
Okay. That's what's up. Speaking of talents, and you had spoke so well on growing your talent as time goes by. Like, do you agree with like the whole self-taught situation? Like, do you agree that a lot of us should be self-taught other than like go to school for certain things like this, because it's just like, usually I feel like, and this is no way, shape, or form a slight to anyone who's been to college. However, I do feel like college is more for certification than, you know, the know-how. If that's the case, then I feel like people should take a lesson in one course in order to learn these things and not everything else. Yes, math is essential. English is essential. But we learned that from the earlier years. You know what I'm saying? Like, these are things that we kind of already know. What about, like, you know, for these lawyers that want to pass the bar, or, you know, these doctors that want to learn how to do surgery? Same difference. If you want to learn how to do fashion, you should only have to take one course for certification. That's my opinion. What do you think?
Okay, so this is a tricky question. Because we're self-taught, so it's easy for us to just say correct. That. You get what I'm saying? But I wouldn't say that everyone should be self-taught, because even though we're self-taught, like, there's still a lot of stuff that we have to still learn. You understand what I'm saying? And it's also, I also feel like people that go in through schools, they actually go, it's a lot of things that they do learn that they don't necessarily have to pay for to learn like that. But then they also get a lot of connections throughout the facilities that they work in and the people that they connect with in these buildings. So, I mean, I don't know. It's a tricky question. Like, I wouldn't necessarily say that, but I would say if there are people out there that's thinking of being a self-taught designer, mm-hmm. that they shouldn't have anything to discourage them, because they could definitely do it. Because by taking classes, like you said, you don't necessarily have to take a whole, you don't have to go to school for years just to become a designer. You can actually take certain classes and learn the certain things that you want. And then on your own time, you could just learn on YouTube or from other places, because there's sewing classes and all types of videos and how-tos all out there on YouTube. So I feel like it shouldn't be a problem.
Correct. I definitely agree. I did want to ask a question, you know, because a lot of people aren't familiar with, like, where we're from. Like, we're not from the same exact area, but we're from where we're from. We're from Brooklyn, New York, no doubt about it. The fond memories that I have of Brooklyn was definitely style, but I feel like the concept of style didn't hit my brain until I saw the most colors ever. And I saw the most colors ever on a pimp that sat on Pickens Avenue. I kid you not. Literally, there used to be a game store right up the block. No problem for us to get any early releases or late releases that came out, or whatever the case may be, you know? But it was this pimp that used to sit right in front of the pizza shop, not too far away from the Chase on Pickens Avenue. When I tell you, he was probably one of the snazziest dressers I've ever seen, like, ever seen. Literally to the point where I watched Good Times and thought that might have been the Pig and Pimp on TV. I kid you not. But yeah, that's kind of where my style comes from, as far as like the colors and like the brighter the colors, the better the silhouettes. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's definitely there, you know? It's a lot of memories that kind of drove me into fashion design, along with, you know, what influenced me as far as fashionistas is concerned, you know, street hustlers that used to dress up in Dapper Dan wear, doing my history and stuff like that. That's what's pretty much driving me. So let me ask you, what about the city that we're from put us in the state of mind to be fashion designers like we are, from your perspective?
Okay, so I just want to start off by saying I was inspired by somebody that I lived with, also the streets, because I was raised in a household with my Haitian grandmother. So she always sewed like our clothing and things together. So that's how I kind of got in tune with the fashion. Like, I would watch her, but I wasn't really into it until I really got into my teens, but I knew how to do it. But then growing up like in the streets, like, cause my dad, he was from Haiti, but when they came to New York, like, he switched he came to New York as a kid or whatever, but you know, he started switching, like, he was always into like brands and stuff like that. So he always had me in like cross color, like the brand cross colors, or Tommy, Guess, Boss. Like, it was just different, like mixed colors that I will always be into. And then Uh-huh. Right, so he, you know, I feel like my pops really had got me into it. Cause I'm really, I really love streetwear. Like that's what I'm really into. So, I feel like my pops was one of the real big inspirations, with my, you know, with my clothing and my colors and all of that different stuff. But basically where I'm from, the streetwear is as well from where we from, you know, I feel like I actually wanted to ask you a question too, but I'm gonna ask after that. But I feel like New Yorkers, I feel like we inspire people all over the world with our style, honestly.
Right. I mean, hello, we are the fashion capital of like the world.
Right. So go ahead.
Yeah. No. I was just about to say like a lot of our style is, you know, mimicked and, you know, done over. Not well, but it's done over. But have you seen the Louis V collection with the last Louis V collection? I think with Virgil it was. I'm not sure if it was him, but there was a jacket inspired by Pele Pele. Pele Pele, we all know, resided out in Harlem. Like, we all know that the style itself came from Harlem. We don't credit it as much. But yeah, there's a Louis V jacket in pretty much Pele Pele stitching, and it's so, so dope. But it's mimicked so terribly. Like, it's one color. We all know Pele Pele's. They got multiple stitchings and all that good stuff. You know what I'm saying? Like, it we know a good Pele Pele when we see it.
No, yeah, definitely. But I never knew that there was, like, a collab, like, a mix with them, with the two, honestly. I never saw a Louis V Pele in my life.
I feel like it was inspired by, like, Pele Pele. I wouldn't say it necessarily a collab, but it was inspired. Absolutely.
Right. I was also, what was I going to say? I also, because my grandmother's Haitian, so she always had lots of prints because, I don't know, she always had like a whole bunch of fabrics with prints and stuff. So I think that's one of the reasons why when I design, I like to mix color, like all different types of prints, some that match, some that don't match, or solid colors with prints, because I don't know, that's just like my aesthetic that I like to do. Like, I feel like that's me. I like to mix and match and not do what you're supposed to do in the fashion industry, like what they say you can't mix and match. I like to mix and match.
Yeah, break all the damn rules.
Exactly.
Okay, so guys, we hit past the 15-minute mark, so you know what that means. Balls to the wall. I'm not holding back. Anyways, listen. So I did want to bring to your attention, like, the new releases and things of that nature. I wanted to ask about it. Maybe you looked at the Adidas and Prada's collab that's coming out. Like, did you see?
Yes. All right, so
shit about to get real, y'all. Hold on.
Okay, so I looked at the I saw the Adidas and Prada collab, and honestly, it's given Ivy Park to me. It's given Beyonce brand. It's given the same thing. Like, it's given repetitive. It's given use an independent black designer and stop using, like, it's given try something new. Like, that's what it's given to me. But I'm sorry. But that's what it's given to me. You could give me your input, though.
But then when there's things of the nature of, like, you know, them not actually hiring black designers, that also becomes a problem as well. You know, in order to actually have fresh, new black designs, you actually have to have the most important ingredient, black designers. Like, that's just simple and plain. Like,
exactly. And that goes back to, you know, I'm into streetwear a lot, and I'm inspired by a lot of the clothes that I do design as well. I get the latest drop sneakers, so I'm inspired. Some of the collections or things that I make, I'll be inspired by a sneaker. And Kool Kai, I don't know if you heard of Kool Kai. I've been talking about him lately, but he's one of those people that he was a black designer, and he came out with a sneaker, and he went to Nike, and he went to Adidas, and they wasn't really trying to mess with him because, you know, he's a black designer, whatever the case may be. But he didn't have that much, I don't know if he didn't have that much clout, whatever the case may be, but he had this really good idea, picture, but they, you know, they shut him down. But now he's doing so much, like, he's doing so great in life right now. Like, I sometimes feel like he's a little cocky, but I feel like he should be at times. But, like, there was a lot of companies that shut him down just because he was a black guy. And I be feeling him sometimes, like, the same way how he be feeling. Not that I feel like I would be the same way, but I understand how he feel, because imagine all of that he had to go through. Like, that's kind of crazy. That's really... That's just, like, that could really discourage somebody from really trying to make their dreams happen. So I really hate that.
Discouragement and just like being feeling blackballed by someone who is supposed to be in the same industry as you is not good. It's sort of under the comparison of, you know, the martial arts community dismounting Bruce Lee from off his pedestal because of the simple fact that he was teaching different cultures his art. You understand what I'm saying? It's similar. Or, you know, different people outcasting Basquiat because of the simple fact that he was A, black, and B, for the simple fact that he was one of those people who broke all the rules. I feel like in fashion, you're allowed to break whatever fucking rule you would decide with no problem at all. I don't feel like there are any hinges or rules, or should be any hinges or rules on what fashion really is, except for your, if you're what's the term you call it, Jess? I don't want to mess it up.
Are you talking about the Teletubby?
Absolutely.
Brands? Oh, okay. Teletubby brands. No. And by, because I don't want people to think that it's shady, but by Teletubby brands, we basically mean sweatsuits that just slap logos on it, or names, or a picture, or a word. And they just go on and say, hey, I have this, I have this, I have that. But they have it in different colors, every flavor, like... we call those Teletubby brands. Like, I feel like, yeah, that's basically what it is.
Yeah, I feel that. I feel like definitely, definitely. I didn't want to get it wrong, so I had to ask you about it. Definitely. That all goes into the cadence of, you know, all money, no talent, you know, but let me not go there. Some people might actually get offended by this conversation. But well, we're breaking the rules anyways. Who gives a damn? As far as the new releases goes, I did hear, a little birdie told me, that Kanye is linking up with Air Jordan. And I am dying to see the designs they have for that. I have not yet looked at anything. What exactly can you tell me about that, though, Jess?
Okay, so they really haven't really been talking too much about it, but if you check on Kanye's, like, if you actually go on Kanye, because Kanye made an Instagram, like, I think this year he never had one. So he's been posting certain like outfits and stuff that I think he's gonna be dropping, like the boots, and he actually just like, I think he actually took everything down because now that I'm back on his site, it's not there. But and then he also has this STEM player thing that he has now, like this app where I think you're going to have to go through the app to see a lot of the things now, because that's a way of him trying to generate more funds and stuff through that too. But I feel like the Jordan, I haven't seen it yet, but I'm interested to see what the sneaker would be like. Not even like what his clothes might be. I don't know if they're going to do a clothing collab as well. I don't know. But the sneakers in general, I feel like it's going to be like... I don't know. Kanye's like a whole genius to me. Like, I love Kanye. A lot of people don't like him. I love him. I feel like he's a genius. He's a god. Like, he's Jesus, like he really says. Like,
definitely.
He's Jesus, like he says. Like, even though he went through his whole mental breakdown, like, I feel like he's a whole person, and people need to realize that he's a person. And, you know, people go through things, and, you know, like, I don't know. Even through his hard times, he still bounced back, and he's doing a lot of things. He's still up on, you know, he's a billionaire now. Like, it's a lot of things that he's doing. But I feel like the sneaker in general is going to be crazy and insane, the collab.
Right. And you know what's crazy? I have a funny story about Kanye West. One time I actually met him at a sneaker release, surprisingly. And it was when he was actually working with like Nike and on Air Yeezys, the first rendition of the Air Yeezys. Because for him to be a pioneer in so many things, in so many ways, sneaker culture, fashion, low-key production, like, people don't realize it. Like, he's been pivotal in so many things, and I don't think he gets enough flowers for it. I'm gonna be honest with you, I don't.
He doesn't. And you know what's crazy? You know Robin Williams, right?
Comedy genius. Yes,
like, I love Robin Williams. But long story short, I brought him up because he was able to take homeless people off the street and have them in some of his movie sets, right? And recently, Kanye, he wanted to, at least I heard, he wanted to take homeless people off the street and have them model in some of his show, like his latest show for, I guess, the Fashion Week that was coming up. But they denied him. And I felt like... I just didn't like that. But mind you, remember when he came out with the clothes where it looked like, people kept saying, oh, it looked like slave clothes, it's rags, this, that, and the third. Remember when he came out with his
Correct. Correct.
So I felt like he was a genius behind that brand because, not to say like that, but you know, the people that's going to buy his brand the most, like that, because it's going to be, you know, the white people out there. They're going to spend the most bread on that. And in my head, I'm thinking of it as him getting back from slavery, like, because of what they, you know, I'm just thinking of, I just had to think of it deeper, like, because I don't know, I didn't really like the brand, but I felt like that's what was his meaning behind it. What'd you think?
I definitely think his way of doing the Adidas brand and the Yeezy clothing was a big F you to the fashion industry. I'm not gonna lie to you. Like how I consider, you know, Virgil Abloh to be one of the pioneers that set forth, like, you know, his clothing was pretty much a diss track to the English language, pretty much, in my opinion. But everybody sees his art different ways. I've been following Kanye since before I could release a rap lyric. And from what I know, you know, he was definitely, like, I feel like his introduction into Adidas, I kind of knew he was going to be on some bullshit for real. Like, his sneakers, dope. Thus far, no question. However, his clothing being questionable is what it was supposed to be. He's never going to fall short as far as the sneaker culture is concerned, from what I've seen. However, with fashion, you see the difference between what he did with Gap and the difference between what he did with Adidas. And you can see a clear, distinctive difference between the two. Like, for instance, his bubble coats for Gap. They're form-fitting, and they're perfect for you, and they're so comfortable, as opposed to the Yeezys clothes. Those didn't sell as much as the Yeezy sneakers, and you know why? Because of the simple fact that the Yeezy clothes were not meant to be worn. They were meant to be gazed upon as a social experiment, in my opinion. That's my opinion, but I could be very, 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 very wrong about where I see it. I don't know.
I don't know. I feel like you could be wrong because I'm a Yeezy head. Like, I have a couple of Yeezys, and there's a lot of people out here. I know you out here in Brooklyn, right. And I know you see a lot of people out here with Yeezys on. So just imagine, like, all over the world. Like, I don't know.
No. I agree.
Compared to every sneaker that's out here right now in the world, you see a lot of people. If you see a lot of people wearing a lot of the same sneakers, I would go with, like, I see a lot of Yeezys out here. I see a lot of, I still see Nikes. I still see a lot of things, but I'm just going over the things that I see that's like a natural pattern, like sneaker wise.
I agree. Like I said, as far as sneaker culture is concerned, Kanye has never fell short. Even with the Nikes, them Red Octobers will forever be a pivotal stance in the Nike culture and sneaker culture thus far. However, when I talk about his clothing that he did with Adidas, that was more of the social experience. Kind of like how Balenciaga is coming out with pretty much dad shoes and people don't acknowledge that shit. Like, people don't understand, like, these things are literally social experiments to see how crazy people are to buy these labels. You notice
that What's dad shoes? Like, dad hats? Dad shoes?
Like, you know what, have you ever seen a pair of Asics?
Yes.
I mean, like, the really, 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 really bad pair of Asics. Okay, not okay. The gel, but those. You notice a significant difference, well, the significant similarities between that and the Balenciaga shoes? Slightly?
I mean, it's the sole, like, the bottom part of the sneaker, basically.
Yeah, the trainer sole is definitely dope. It's definitely dope. I agree. I'll say this.
You actually right. It's just that Balenciaga just look a little bit thicker and harder than the Asics because it's more Asics is more of a running shoe, so it has that softer look appeal. So that's like the only, you know. But I get the similarity, right.
A lot of people around, like, you know, Eastern New York and New Lots have a lot of pairs of Yeezys. Definitely, that's not. But you know, what's crazy. Sneaker culture has changed so much over the years. Even to the point where I noticed significant differences. Like, my first crush I got with a pair of cherry 12s and some, you know, academic sweats. You know what I'm saying? I lost her out in the same day to a dude in the Atlanta Falcons hat, but that didn't mean much. You know what I'm saying? But it just shows how well and how kept fashion culture was before the pandemic. Now I feel like it took a really big hit. I'm not going to lie. People aren't just doing, it's not anarchy like it was. Anarchy in fashion is a good thing, and people don't realize that because people are able to do exactly what they want to do in life with their fashion. You understand what I'm saying? Now all these, now with all these Teletubby brands, like you so well eloquently put it, people are just allowed to just do the bare minimum and sell to their friends and families other than actually being a household name. You understand what I'm saying? Like, it's household names don't exist no more. Everything is about a dollar when it comes to fashion, and it's the worst. I'm not gonna lie. It's speaking of new lots in East New York, you know what I'm saying? Like, it just take certain clothes take me back to a simpler time, like, you know, the ice cream truck being like the groundhog for the summertime, and, you know, the hydrants being on after 12, and, you know, the adults going to play in the hydrants, and, you know, shit like that. It takes me back to a much simpler time, you know?
Nah, I feel you. But I do have a question, though. What season, if you was to have a season that was your flyest season, what season would it be?
Oh, it's easily the spring. Easily the spring. Because my favorite outerwear is bomber jackets. Bomber jackets, you can't miss, you can't hit. Bomber jackets will never go out of style for nothing, whether you have a team on it or not. You can have a construction company on your bomber jacket and it'll flow, you know? That's why spring is my favorite season, and because bright colors, that's why. Neon colors, brighter colors, things of that nature, they, you know, they epitomize fashion.
Okay, I dig it. But I would say my favorite season would be winter. It would be like winter, spring, but mostly winter, only because I do love popping out in fly ass coats that I make. You know, and I know, I don't know if everybody be popping out like that. And you spoke about colors. Like, I'm always using colors in my, like, that's what my whole, like, brand is about. Mm-hmm. Like, I love color. So even in the wintertime, like, I'll pop out in some colorful ass shit. But just know it's going to be warm as fuck. Excuse my language, but it's going to be warm. You feel me? And it's going to be fly. So I just feel like the wintertime is my favorite time. I could make.
So freaking lutely. Absolutely. I love the wintertime. Trust me. I get ashy, but I love the wintertime. Trust me.
That's funny. Not you get ashy. But yeah, I could make a freaking, like, one of my favorite outfits that I made for the wintertime was this puffer coat with this puffer skirt. And then I made, like, these leg warmers. But it was like, and I had, like, these piping in it. Like, I put these fire piping in it. It was, like, so dope. So every time I went outside, I would still be warm, just even though my legs was out a little bit, because everything was puffer. So I would still pop out looking fly and different. So I don't know. I just like the winter. I like the winter time. I love it. I just hate the weather, but I love summer and spring, the weather-wise. But I also like the spring because of colors and stuff as well. But, yeah.
But, yeah, the winter time is definitely that time of year where you kind of, like, you get into the motions of, you know, what you want to wear, like pea coats are in, things of that nature. Shit. I used to know, I used to keep a good pea coat or two in the summertime, in the winter. I'm sorry, not the summer. Why would I wear a pea coat in the summer? I don't want to burn myself alive. Jesus Christ.
I'm sorry. I forgot to say pea coats as well, because I love pea coats too, and I make them as well. So I definitely forgot about pea coats.
I'm gonna need an original from you. Definitely, I'm definitely gonna need an original peacoat from you for certain, because that's my peacoats and polo shirts.
Listen, I'm working on this one peacoat right now. I plan on dropping it in the spring. I think I'm gonna finish it for this fashion show, but it's so much detail that I put in the coat. Like, it's so much detail. It took me. I don't want to say almost a year, but I would say, like, because I've done it, you know, I take breaks and I work on a whole bunch of other stuff as well. So I want to say if I actually worked on it at straight out of time, it probably would have took me like probably 5 months to do.
Damn. That's actually pretty fast for a peacoat. I'm not going to lie.
Nah, but I'm just saying it's the detail. I feel like I could have probably made it faster, but the detailing of it just took the process longer, and I'm still like, but it's going to be dope. It's going to be dope.
Right. Yeah, I usually sit up here like so out of the ordinary question, right? I do want to ask you, what is one song that is undeniably on your playlist? Like, it's a shot in the dark, but what's a song that's undoubtedly on your playlist when it comes to, you know, starting up your clothing?
Have you ever heard a song? See, I listen to a lot of different music. Like, even though I'm from the hood, like, I listen to all different types. Like, I listen to a lot of telepop music when I'm, like, really in my zone. So there's this one song called Bittersweet. I don't know if you ever heard the Devil Wears Prada. I mean, if you ever saw the movie The Devil Wears Prada.
Indeed.
So majority of the songs in that movie are a majority of the songs that I listen to when I'm in my zone. Like, I listen to those kind of music, those kind of songs. Like, I like that.
Oh, okay. It's a tie. I have a tie. It's either Coldplay Lost or Molly Vengeance. Like, I have to listen to that song. I have to listen to it. Like, if I don't, then I feel like my equilibrium is off around my sewing machine. I won't be able to function straight. So, yeah. Molly Vengeance is more or less the choice for me. I'm not going to lie. Did you know that he's just released a video not too long ago? The visuals are dope. I fuck with it. I fuck with it for real. Like, it's heavy. I fuck with it heavy.
I wouldn't really expect that, but okay.
You got to check it out. It's definitely dope.
But I also wanted to just reset the room real quick because it's 8:06. So how long would you like the podcast to last for?
We're gonna edit this part out anyway, so it's fine. How long do you have? Because we definitely got to get to the other topics.
I mean, it still doesn't matter. I'm asking you.
Oh, okay. So we can do it for as long as we do these topics. We do want to involve everybody in the chat, by the way. So if you just came in, evert to the group chat that we have, not my back channel, or her back channel. Questions, comments, concerns, and gripes go into the group chat. And if you just got in here, definitely share.
Right. Or if you guys even have any questions, like, that you want us to answer in regards to anything, like.
Yeah, we're answering them live and in person. So definitely send in those questions about what you might have a wonder about. But continuing on, okay, so should we start from here and just kind of like, you know, get to the real gist of shit? Because I got another topic I want to bring up.
Yeah, bring all the topics.
All right, cool. So, yeah, I couldn't believe I lost out to that dude in the Atlanta Falcons hat. My Atlanta Hawks hat was way fresher than his. I know it was because his was tilted in. It didn't have no shape to it. Mine was plainly brand new. Like, I lost out to a dude who sat on his hat before class. Like, I couldn't believe it. Like, I was pissed off for a while behind that. I just found it on social media not too long ago, man. That's crazy.
That's funny. I'm not too familiar with that, but that's funny.
No. That's how you had to dress back then. Like, when I was in school, that's how you kind of had to dress. I'm not going to lie. It was either that or you had the big Pele with the bad fitted. And it was very rare that you wore an NFL fitted to school. Like, you never did that. You had to wear a basketball team or a baseball team. More than likely, the baseball teams cost more, but we settled for the basketball teams. Like, all right, you in there, but watch out, nigga. Like, you ain't there yet. Like, well, it was a lot of that. You can just imagine when snapbacks were popular back when I was in high school. It was a long ride on the L train all the way to New Lots for me. I promise you. My Sharks hat got stolen. I got beat up for my San Jose Sharks snapback when I first got it. I kid you not. I was one of the first people in school with a snapback on. With like a pair of J's and, you know, a Vans t-shirt. My Vans t-shirt was destroyed. Not to mention, my J's scuffed to high hell and my snapback gone. Let me tell you. And a lot of the times, like that ride from Bedford Avenue all the way to New Lots, for me, was hell. You either got into a relationship or a fight, all in the same sentiment. I swear to God, it was hell going to school and from school. Because if you had an op going to automotive or something like that, you was getting beat up by three people. Not just the one you had beef with, three people. And that was the trouble with it. We had beef for years.
That's crazy. Yeah, I never really got into I never really got into fights and stuff like that over anything I had on. Like, not a Sherlin, anything, like, nothing.
So
like,
you got to keep your nails on your fingers. That's good.
Mm-hmm. Yep, I ain't have none of those problems. But I can say that I was the first, because I heard you saying that you was the first to wear that outfit in your school. I was the first to wear a Rockaway sweatsuit in my elementary school. Like, I felt so, like, I felt like I started a trend. I started a trend, like, because even one of the popular, because at that time I wasn't like popular or didn't really know too much people, and one of the popular boys had came to me and he had asked me, where did I get my outfit from? And I told him my pops bought it. Like, I didn't know. So that's definitely, it was a navy blue and white velour suit. I'll never forget it. And I had on some Nikes, some type of Nikes on. You know, back in the 90s, they had all different type of fly Nikes, reflect, like, it was all different types of Nikes back in the 90s. But yeah, I was just mad excited that I started a trend in elementary. But you said you was gonna hit me with a question. What was that question? Hello.
Oh, my bad. It's kind of hard. I forgot the question that you wanted me to ask, considering the fact that there's like a few questions in here. I totally forgot. It slipped my mind. Maybe I smoke too much weed, or maybe I don't smoke enough. I don't know. Maybe. I'm not sure. But
Did you hear what I asked you, though? Because I'm not sure if my service went out. Did you hear what I asked you? Or did you hear what I said?
Nah, I didn't, actually.
I was talking about the outfit that I wore in elementary.
Okay. Yeah. I think he was into Rockefeller a lot. I think your dad might have been into a Rockefeller a lot. The outfit is fresh. What color was the sweatsuit, though? I need to know.
So what part didn't you hear? Because I kept on talking, but I think my service was acting up. But basically, I was saying I felt like I started a trend because I had wore this Rockaway sweatsuit. It was basically like navy blue velour with it had like white piping on the sides, and it had the white Rockaway words in it. And I had these fly ass Nikes on, because you know, back in the 90s they had like different type of Nikes out there that was really fly,
right?
I don't really remember what kind it was, but yeah, that's basically the rundown.
right. That's a fleet fit. It's a real fleet fit.
Mm-hmm.
I think I would wear that nowadays, I'm not gonna lie.
Yeah, so my pops used to dress me up like a tomboy a lot too. So I think that was the thing too.
Damn, tough crowd.
Mm-hmm.
Wait, did you have the headband with it though?
I don't think I did. I don't think I did. Not the wrist. Not around the wrist either. I don't think I did.
That's okay. You know what's crazy? I used to wear Team Rock. I don't know if that's the same rendition. I know it's the same brand, but not the same rendition as like Rockaware. But like, you know, like I had the American colored Team Rock short sleeve jersey with my I think Moschino jeans and my eights and my playoff eights back in junior high school, and I thought I was doing it. Until son told me, like, yo, we don't do Team Rock no more, bro. We don't do it. And I'm just like, wow. I can't get my ass, my jeans and my sneakers. Like,
that's wow, like bro. Wearing S. Dot Carter's.
Well, you had a pair?
No, I'm just saying, wearing that is like wearing S. Dot Carter's.
funny enough, don't first of all, I'm not gonna have the slander on S. Dot Carter. You know why?
You used to rock them.
No. That's the crazy thing. They came from the same brand that used to bring me my G Unit sneakers. Cause we not gonna do this slander with S. Dot Carter's. I wanted a pair back in the days, but I could not get them. All right. My pops got me G-Unit. My pops literally told me in detail, this is a G-Unit household, and got me a pair of white and army fatigue G-Unit sneakers. And G-Unit sneakers in 2005 is crazy.
No way. I'm letting you know
right now.
No way. No way.
Army fatigue fit to go with it was wicked, and he got me the G-Unit tank top. Oh man, it was the worst. I think I cried at that barbecue that year. I'm not gonna lie. The year I wore that shit at the barbecue, I cried. Literally. Not laughing, but cried in agony because I didn't want them shits. I wanted some S. Dot Carter's. And my pops was like, no, this is a G-Unit household. And I thought he was playing until he picked the sneakers up, like, yo, you getting these. I'm like, shit.
That's crazy. Yeah, nah. See, my pops grew up, like I told you, he grew up in a Haitian household, like, and then they moved here. So he didn't really have a lot growing up. But then once he was able to make his own bag, he was always buying the latest, the flyest. And then he had me in the latest and the flyest because where he came from, he worked so hard. He just always wanted to have the latest and have me in the latest. And I felt like he probably never wanted to just go back, like, or have to rethink that life or whatever the case may be. So,
Right.
Like, he had to wear one pair of sneakers for, like, the whole year type of time when he was young. Because my grandmother had four kids. Uh-huh. My Haitian grandmother had four kids. So, she wasn't getting them sneakers like that. So, then, yeah, he was going off.
So, was Burberry popping at the baby showers or not? They had the baby shower shirts back then, too?
Oh, nah. See, I wasn't wearing Burberry, though. Like, I wasn't wearing Burberry back in the day.
Mm-mm. Nah?
No.
Wait, but did you go to certain baby showers back in the day where they was wearing, you know, the Burberry or the baby shower shirts? Come on, now.
All the time. They still do it to this day.
Nah, I ain't been to a baby shower in years, bro. That's the reason I'm asking.
That's funny. They definitely. I'm a little older than you. Not too old. I think I'm like 4 years older than you.
Just about. I'm 27.
Oh yeah, probably five. I'm 31. I think it's 4 or 5. But yeah, when I was in high school, I was wearing. I remember I had these I used to wear Blazers a lot, like, you know, the Nike Blazers, because they was out back then. So those was like my favorite sneakers. And I used to wear these sneakers called Ponies. Ooh. It looked like it was like Vans way before Vans. Like,
nah, they kind of remind me of the PF Flyers a little bit. I'm not gonna lie, they definitely remind me of the PF Flyers. And
what, as Ponies?
Far as the Blazers is concerned, you're talking to somebody who do their own custom Blazers. Come on now, like, that's my staple.
Yep, you could never go wrong with a pair of Blazers.
That's the thing. You can never go wrong with it. You definitely can. So, would you do high top or low top Blazers?
I would do high top. I wouldn't do low top. I didn't even know they had. Yeah, I wouldn't do low top.
So you, known for dressing as a tomboy back in the day, right? No slight, because it's still dope. You feel me? The Rockaway suit and shit like that was dope. So you wouldn't bust a low top pair of Nike Blazers with some high two socks, some khaki shorts, you know, a polo shirt, some aviator glasses, the see-through ones, you know, the clear ones, not the sunglasses, or maybe the sunglasses, and, you know, a backwards neon cap. You wouldn't do that? By the way, pregame.
I'm actually looking it up right now on my computer because I don't know what low top Nike Blazers look like, so I gotta see.
But you know, you gotta
even agree. Oh, I don't know. Right? I'm lying. I actually know what they look like. I never really liked that style. Actually, I never.
You know what? Just for y'all, right? This summer, I'm gonna take a picture with the entire fit on. Nike Blazers, high striped. Tube socks, by the way, khaki shorts, my pink polo shirt and a neon snapback with some dollar bills tucked to the side one time on some 90s hustler, feel me? I got y'all.
You so funny. And you know what's crazy? My pops, he used to wear the Rockaway suits. He used to have the one leg up with the sneakers. And he used to do that with his Eniche suits. I don't know if you remember Eniche. He used to wear all of that. But to this day, he wears polo. Like, polo is like his favorite thing to wear, like all the way down to his socks. Polo everything. Like, everything. Like, he's one of those polo heads. Like, you know how back in the days they had like that gang of polo people? Like, he's like
gang of the gang of misfits that robbed the polo store.
Exactly. My hero. He's like that. I'm like, yo, dad, you gotta chill. Like, them and every it'd be so, yeah, he gotta chill.
You know what's funny? I personally know one of the low heads for real. Like, I gotta get him to create a clubhouse and come onto the show. Definitely. I have to tell us what the culture was like back then. Like, that polo era was so crazy. The ski bubbles and the low rugby shirts and stuff like that. Like, the parkas that used to have, like, the pockets. Like, the shit that Raekwon had in one of his videos. I forgot which video it was. But I think it was Lynx Club or some shit like that.
But you know what's crazy? I'm sorry to cut you off. They still be having, like, last year that just passed, they recently still be popping out, like, outside, and they be doing they pop out in the latest fashions, and they pull out stuff that they have in their bag, and they be showing stuff off. Like, they still be having, like, little shows outside with them. Like, one day I'm going to send you a video. I'm going to send it to you tonight if I find it.
Oh, hell yes.
But they be doing it to this day, but you could tell, like, they the old heads, they the OGs, like, from back in the days.
Right, crazy. Right, right. And they still wearing their polo.
But the stuff they put, the stuff they be having out, or they pull out their bags, or they be wearing, be like, yo, like, you're not seeing that in Macy's, or you're not seeing that, like, it's super right. Fire.
speaking of, like, that's something you pull out of the archives, though, you feel me? That's something Ralph Lauren would pull out of the archives, feel me? Speaking of archives, right, did you see the bubble jacket, like the velvet bubble jacket that Tommy Hilfiger dropped like a few years ago, bro? Like, when I tell you this jacket was so fresh, it was so fresh. I enjoyed looking into that shit. It was so dope. I love that jacket so much to the point where it's just like, yo, like, I fuck with it heavy, like, really, really heavy, you know? It's a dope-ass jacket. You should definitely look into it, for sure, for sure.
Yeah, I'm going to definitely check it out, because, you know, I love bubbles. But you said you was going to hit me with a question. What's that question?
The question is, did you ever date outside of your style? Have you ever dated outside of your swag, pretty much? Like a person who don't really, you know, you feel like don't dress as well or whatever the case may be. You gave him a shot? You ever gave him a shot at all? Because I know I have plenty of times.
I mean, I actually have. I definitely have. Like, but it was nothing really too bad, because it's not like they was out looking crazy still. However they wore their clothes, even though it was different from mine's, they didn't look dirty. So it was passable. But yeah, when I'm out, like, to this day, I'm like real, like, you could see me, like, you'll see me in a room, like, from across the room. Like,
right. Abstract. Not even so much abstract, but just there. It. You know, your pronouns is it. Just like my pronouns is it, for sure. But another question is, right, what would be considered passable, now that we segue into this, you know, this subject? What, if you had an outfit in mind, right, for it just being passable, what would it be? This is a good one. I gotta see this. I gotta hear this.
So a a passable outfit would be,
right, like, just making it.
That's not even my style. Like, a passable outfit would be some Ewens with some good, I guess, some type of style jeans, like zippers or like ribbed, something like that, and maybe a nice little sweater to go with it, like, you know, like the fitted little sweaters, and like a fitted or a snapback. That's a passable fit to me.
All right, okay. So, to answer your question, for me, right, a passable fit, for, this one's hard because I don't put as much pressure on a woman to dress up as much as I would, because at the end of the day, like, y'all have outlets to go to, like Rainbows and Denise and things of that nature. Like, us, all we not, have is, like...
Not Denise, though. I haven't heard of Denise. I'm sorry to cut you off again. I haven't heard of Denise since, like, 20 years ago. Like, that's crazy.
Denise is still active and alive on in the Crown Heights section. I haven't walked past plenty of them recently, but... As far as what I'm saying is, there's not a lot of pressure on y'all to overdo dressing up, except for paying overpriced for maybe a bag or an accessory. I could be wrong, or your footwear for that matter. You get what I'm saying? As opposed to a guy from head to toe, he has to be name brand something in order to be established as like a fly dude or whatever the case may be, or even be passable for that matter. So it's a lot more pressure on us to go to these designer stores and go to these different places in order to like rock out. Me per se, I feel like I'm always dating out of my swag, but it could change over time. I'm hoping it changes over time. Another thing I did want to, you know, bring to your attention or whatever the case may be is the fact that like fashion took a really big hit during the pandemic, so we kind of don't really know what fashion really is or what it means to be fashionable these days, because people are just getting away with, you know, fashion suicide. Just, you know, monochrome is just like, it drives me crazy to see nothing but monochrome everything. It's cheating in a way. Like, it's like a dude that always wears a suit, that's cheating, you know, things of that nature, you know. I consider it cheating, at least, you know, or a dude who just wears nothing but name brand but looks terrible. I hate stuff like that. It's just not it. It's not it. And a lot of the times we'll sit up here and we'll try to justify it, like, you know, different things of that nature. By the way, that cough was a slight to somebody that's not in here right now. I'm just kidding. But it's definitely something to be withheld. It's definitely something to be withheld, to cheat in a way, if you want to call it that. Another collab I wanted to speak on was, what was it? Oh, no.
Did you see if there was questions in the chat? I'm sorry. Did you see if there was questions in the chat?
I definitely did not. Will y'all come to... One of the questions is for both of us, actually. Wow, that's crazy. Thank y'all. Will y'all come down to Dallas for a pop-up shop at the World Trade Center? What do you think, Jess?
I mean, you answer it first.
I mean...
I don't have a problem. I don't have problems going to pop-ups or... But it has to just make sense for me, like, in some kind of way. Like, am I going to be included in this pop-up shop? Are we working together in a pop-up shop? Are we collabing in a pop-up shop?
Correct. Me, I would go to Dallas just for the hell of it. I'm not going to lie. I want to go to a Cowboys game. I want to do everything like that. I just want to do it. But, I Yeah, I'm here. My fault. Yeah, I just want to go to Dallas for the hell of it. I'm not going to lie to you guys. Like, it's going to be fun. And in the background, yeah, fashion designers still need to work. So it's my 9-to-5, guys. I'm working in security right now. Mind you, I'm 150-something pounds. I don't know how I fit in here. That's what she said.
I got in there last night. I'm like, no, I'm not.
Pause. Nah, but go ahead, Jess. My fault.
No, you're totally fine.
This is actually good content for the podcast. To know that, like, everybody working, like, everyday jobs, it's pretty cool. But anyways, do you have any insight into the fashion world that maybe I don't?
Yo, let me get the binder.
As far as what, like, what do you mean that maybe you don't? Because, you know, I don't know your whole fashion insight. So, what do you mean exactly?
Basically, like any fashion shows coming up, anything spectacular in the works, you know, things of that nature
But yeah,
to plug in.
I was actually, I don't know if I spoke about it earlier, but I'll speak about it again. I was asking if you was gonna be available because in New York, well, you're basically in New York. There's supposed to be a show coming up on the 27th. I believe that they're looking still looking for other designers to participate in it. So yeah, if you are, it's on the 27th of this month of March. So, and then this Sunday we'll actually be looking out this looking at the space at 2 o'clock. So
Absolutely.
yeah,
You
that's like one of the
anywhere there's fashion, I'll be there. No problem. No problem. I'm
like.
gonna have to tell my job to kick rocks for the day, but yeah, it's definitely going down. I'm going. I'm definitely going.
Or maybe you could just probably ask to make up your day. Like, what if you take that day off and just make it up on your day you are off?
Right,
Could you do that?
I'll
Or
ask and inquire about it before I leave here at 11, but definitely, I'm definitely going to see to it that that happens. Definitely. But yeah, definitely. I want to do this so much. Do you know that this is my first fashion show?
yes, you was telling me. But you're trust me, it'll be amazing. Like I did my first show when I was 27. So you got this. You got this.
Definitely, definitely. Fingers crossed.
Not fingers crossed. You got this.
So, guys, I believe it's time to say sayonara, arrivederci, sugi sugi, and coupe de ville to all of y'all. So
I was
it
screwed.
was great talking with you guys. Exit left, don't slam the door, and be back next Wednesday for another installment of Don't Watch That Podcast with Jess with the Best and Wes with the
And don't
Rest.
forget to bring your friends, bring your mama, bring your daughter, bring your uncle, bring your papa, and all of
And if your papa
that.
got friends, bring him, bring them, and your mama got friends. All right, y'all, get out of here. Y'all been staying here all week.